number three, if you ask me. This is the most personal song on the album. And it was inspired by conversation I had with Simon Kendall, who also plays Hammond organ on Let Me Burn and William in June. And I happened to meet him on a plane. We were flying back from Vancouver. And I was talking about the album. This is before we had started recording. And he said, you know, it's good that you got back into music. And I thought, I've never gotten out of music, you know. And it's not like music was a second thought to me or a little thing on the side that I got into and I didn't get into and I got back in. I've never left music. It's been in my heart the whole time. So it shocked me that when Simon first met me, I was playing in a band and, along came our daughter Simone and, you know, I did what I thought a good father should do. And I got a real job and made sure that I provided for my family, but I never left music. So it got me thinking. I got home and I instantly wrote this song, if you ask me. And it's simply about the fact that although I loved music and I was pursuing music, that when time came for me to be responsible, I was responsible. And now I'm back into music. And if you ask me, I wouldn't change a thing. Not one single thing of my life. Because I think if you change one thing, you might not have some other thing happen. So maybe I wouldn't have met my wife and had our daughter. I wouldn't change a thing. That's what it's about. A couple of interesting things about the song. On top of that, it's autobiographical completely. So some of the references, like in the opening, packing my drums in the car, that was common for me. I'd pack them into somebody's car and we'd go to a party and play, sometimes in a farmer's field, a couple times. And sometimes if there was no other band, no other musicians, it was just me. And people would listen to me bang the hell out of my drums for hours. So I loved it and people liked to listen to it. And one of the guys that would drive me around was Charlie Vandenbroek. And you hear the reference of Charlie at the beginning. And the fact that he's instrument flying, which simply means that under the influence, he'd have to look at his instruments to fly, if you know what I mean, and resulted in quite a bad accident. He was okay, but on Thrill Hill, not good. Another reference in the song is to a good friend, the late Rick Burt, who was a hometown hero in Waterdown, Ontario, growing up. And he was a friend of mine, and my older brother Dave used to take me with him wherever, and it was really his band. Rick was the guitar player in the band, and he was just such a gifted guitar player and such a wonderful guy. You know, I've never saw him mad, never saw him sad. He was always happy, welcoming, great friend, and a killer guitarist, just amazing. So in the song, we recreated his sound, which was a Marshall stack, a Gibson Les Paul guitar, and a Big Muff and a Space Echo. These were the things that that really was the trademark of his sound. So we recreated that in here. So that's what you hear. There's also a reference to acid or art, and talks about really growing up in a small town and looking for ways to feel like you want to get out of there and throw your plainness away. So was it acid or was it art, meaning music, that we would use? There's also a reference in there about me playing in the bars. And I was in my first band. I got my first job when I was 17 years old. The legal drinking age was 18, so I had to get some kind of certificate to say that I wouldn't drink and I would, but I'd be able to play in the band. So I did. And it was quite an eye opener. And one of the places that we played had a stripper during the day. So it not as glamorous as you think, kind of odd. Even at 17 years old, I thought, man, this is weird. A bunch of smelly drunk guys and this poor woman on stage. It was just weird. And there was a bar fight. And if you've ever been in a band and been on a stage and had a fight break out, it's quite interesting because you're hoping you don't get a glass in the head. And for some reason, you keep on playing and it goes on down there on the dance floor and chairs flying everywhere. very odd. I remember being a little bit frightened and trying to stay in rhythm. And at that time, Patty was my girlfriend, or she was just my friend. She wasn't even my girlfriend then, but we really liked each other. But a guy lifted up a chair, and he was going to hit the guy over there. And when he took the chair and lifted it up, he hit her with the chair. Wasn't good. We can laugh now. And the music, it's funny, when I came home, as I mentioned, to write the song, I worked on the intro. I wanted a guitar intro, and I tried things for about 2 hours. Nothing came. I said, okay, let me try piano. And that opening part, just that was the very first thing I played. And that's what really made the song come to life. But when we were recording the song, Bronx Baby played this guitar part, these arpeggios at the opening that play on top of the arpeggios I'm playing on piano. They're different ones, though. But he came up with this wonderful part, and I remember it just blew me away. I thought, this is so good. I love it. I love when people can add things like that to a song. And then at the end, you hear him, ba-da-da. He's doing these little harmonic bends. You hear the harmonic, and then you hear it bend up. And what you can't see is that he's taking his finger, going past the nut onto the head of the guitar and pushing down just the right amount to bend that up. I guess it's a half a tone or something. And you know, I'm watching him do that and I'm thinking, wow, that's really cool. It's almost got a steel guitar kind of feel to it. So beautiful stuff. And that was song number 3, if you ask me.